Hello everyone. Again, now we can, I think, also officially start, since there will be people joining, of course, the webinar. But now, since it's already 1 and 5, 6 minutes, we can officially start. I would like to welcome you in front of Madame Park. My name is Belma Rizvanovic, and we are, as Madame Park, involved in Internet of Energy EQ Education and Qualification Project. And this is actually our second webinar from this subject that we are working on. This project is financed by Erasmus Plus program, and it's a 3-year-long project. And right now we are in the, let's say, finishing phases, and proudly presenting series of webinars in between actually our partners. And sorry, just a sec, here we are. So a series of webinars that actually we are working on with our partners are also available on our websites. What we will try to do with the Internet of Energy is definitely promote, first of all, this sector. Secondly, develop different kinds of educational resources for Internet of Energy itself. If you go to our website, you will definitely see a lot of things being already developed. And a lot of things being in developing, actually, from different kind of demonstrators to series of webinars and other resources as articles that we presented in the Internet of Energy. So basically, it's from, as we will see today, wireless energy to any kind of smart energy. And there is a lot of new resources that you can see and educate yourself. This project is mainly dedicated actually to students generally for education and qualification, but there is also a lot of resources and a lot of new areas that we want to involve small and medium enterprises, corporations, and actually we already had a lot of webinars that were from different kind of business energy perspective, and we were involved in many areas of Internet of Energy throughout either the content or the webinars that were being done in this project. Our partners are partners from, as you can see, different kind of European partners that present different kind of research centers. And as partners, of course, we deliver different kinds of webinars as this one is. So enough from me. I'm just going to also present to you today's actually topic of webinar is DC grids and wireless internet, energy transfer. Today with me is Professor Stanimir Valchev, which I must say is a very, definitely is a pleasure to have Professor here with us. He is from Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering from Nova School of Science and Technology. Nova University, FCT, also representative of Bulgars Free University, Sofia Technical University, and I must also say that professor has over 50 years of experience in energy sector. He is part of advisory board of Beijing University, Zhao Tong, and has a lot of connections with Internet of Telecommunication and in the Dutch market. So professor, really your experience and your history in the whole business and general Internet of Energy area is very much impressive. Thank you very much for being here with us today. And before you start with a very interesting subject of DC grids and wireless internet transfer, I would just like to also remind participants that of course this is an open webinar, so you can pose questions. You can post them on a message, on a chat actually, that is the usual Zoom chat. You can post them privately to me, or you can send them for everyone. I will do like a usual schedule where professor will present the subject, and then after professor is finished with the presentation, I will be free to ask him the questions. So professor, I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and I would like to welcome you to, first of all, our webinar again, and you can definitely start also with your presentation. So, Professor, welcome.
And okay, thank you for the introduction, Belma. It is so nice to have here these nice people, to see very well maintained girls. And I am presenting the animals that are coming from the underworld, because we were hidden a long time, and I still have quite a beard now, but you can understand this is our protection against the virus. We need to be very ugly in order virus not to attack us. So now I will try to make this page. Yes, this is the page, and then this is here. Now I need to make another wider. Probably it is very nice for you to see it this way. So, the title is DC Grids and Wireless Energy Transfer. In the beginning, I was trying to include more things, especially about the energy harvesting, but it probably will stay, because when I saw that it's almost the same number of slides that are to make better presentation for the energy harvesting, and you know, energy harvesting is also in some books is mentioned even for ocean waves. It is ocean waves harvesting. It is not very nice now to mixture all this, because I will be concentrated mostly on the DC, which I consider as a future, and the wireless energy transfer, and why I consider that they are inseparable, these two. So here we have some points to start by the, they are the only probably thing which is really written here. After that we will have more pictures. I like much more. This is the tradition for me, not to use a text, not this kind of some other countries' traditions to have all this and to read it. But anyway, it is good to know that the system, the power system of all our countries up to this moment is based on AC. AC is 50 hertz or 60 hertz. By historical reasons, it is fixed like this. Maybe we don't like it. Maybe we would like to have it more higher the frequency. But even when we see our frequency, which is produced by the generator, which is on the top of our building, it is not more, never more than 16 hertz, even with the 10 pairs of poles of generator. It's not possible. It is very difficult to change this. And this is one of the limits of our system, as we need motors of 30,000 rotations per minute, and it is not possible to make it by 50 hertz. Okay, then why we are changing? Because we are going now to have more tools to make these changes. We have power devices, power electronic devices. The power electronics DC converters, they are something which are used now to make better transforming of one DC to another DC, which was very important. We will see later. How also is motivated this kind of power electronic inclusion of our converters? This is because the copper is about 8 times more expensive now. The ferrite is almost difficult to find now. The good ferrite is very difficult to find. And then we need to take into account our renewable energy sources. The renewable energy sources are very decentralized. Sometimes we produce on the roof, we produce 2, 3, 4 kilowatts of power. But the smallest block in the data center, the smallest power supply is 150 kilowatts. So we need to have a contribution of many, many, many producers just to have one consumer to take all this energy. This is completely different from what it was. And the DC converters, as they use the transfer of power through a magnetic connection, we will see how they very easily can be seen as a magnetic coupling. So they can be easily making a wireless transfer, or we can make it, we can say it is a wire transfer, but in fact it is a transformer always used, and it is also some classic way of transforming the power. Now, this is why the AC is a problem. One of the big problems of the AC is the omnipresent problem of the synchronization. You can see here some history. You see that the faults the problems which the United States grid is having, they are geometrically growing up. They are very, very highly growing as a number of problems. So the power disturbances are a problem. Why? You see here this diagram. Our frequency, or their frequency, because we are talking about United States, their frequency is 60. And you can count even in many stoves, in many our kitchen utensils, we use this frequency for a clock. Our clock in the kitchen is very correct. Even during 1 year, maybe will be a mistake of not more than 2-3 minutes, which means the frequency is kept very, very correctly at 60 hertz. You can see here the statistics. It's 60 hertz, and very rarely it's going by 50 millihertz down, which is nothing really. It's 1,000 times less. So it is very correct. How to keep that? It's very difficult task. And microgrids can be some solution to that. The problem now at this moment is that we think that microgrid can be a solution, because everybody in his region will be responsible for his consuming and his producing of energy, of power. That is what we call this prosuming, prosumer. He is a consumer, but he can be also a producer. In many places, like in Spain, people constructed this. They made a lot of investment. After that, the government say, no, you will pay taxes for that, but you cannot give that to the grid, which makes the life very unstable. But unstable also is our system. So probably one day in Spain, they will get again this possibility to sell the energy. Now you see that this is a problem. The DC load is very common. The DC producer is a very common producer. So we will see now the history very briefly is becoming a big fight between the Edison and Westinghouse. Of course, on the side of Westinghouse was Tesla, because Tesla was working for Edison in the beginning, but Edison promised to give $10,000 for something, for some solution, and Tesla made it in half an hour, and Edison said that he was just joking, and then it was a personal hatred that appeared at the time. But who was the past? Probably the past was Edison, and the future in the 19th century was Westinghouse. Is it true today? We will see. Now, this was the fight in the beginning, the death of the alignment fix. It was very important what happened, and so many people are looking how he was burned, because he was connecting the AC. The new AC in the United States was because from the Niagara Falls was coming power, and that power was sufficient at that time. It was very, very high. It was 4 megawatt of power. And here also the fight in the newspapers was the fight in the newspapers was people were executing a horse. They were showing that the AC power can kill a horse. Well, why not DC power? Nobody say, but that was in the newspapers. And after that, they decided it's very good for executions. And this is one execution. It was made in the 19th century by the AC power. And it was burnt meat. It was people vomiting. And it was a lot of unhappy things that happened. So, sorry. So it was a little bit very dirty game. Now, the history of the communications and energy also, they can give us also some other logic to decide what is better. At that time was the AC, because we can make high voltage by easily transforming. The transformer still is 99%, can be even 99% of efficient. So the wire of the telegraph was known that at certain distance it was not effective, because it was too much of distance, and the wire for the DC was not very good idea, because it was falling all the power during the transmission was falling on the wires. Well, people went finally to the AC. The AC won. And that is the end of the 19th century. Of course, the telegraph was in the beginning. The telegraph was the first one. I'm always showing that the military people, they need a transmitting of messages. They need to command the troops. So when the power is for the people to be industrialized, to get their homes better, but that is for the peace, not for the war. For the war, the first one was the telegraph, because the telegraph was very important to command the troops. It was the beginning of the big wars in the 19th century. So here is how our energy was in the beginning. The energy was very centralized. It is centralized because you can have here a vision how the computer was in that time. It was one big computer. We had a supercomputer, a UNIVAC. That is something. It was very, very admired at that time, that in the United States they have such a big computer. You can see now the input and output. Probably this kind of computers now, if we compare, because I remember when it was made, a chip which corresponded to the PDP-8, and PDP-8 was in my time, we made in the university a full room empty for this computer and the air conditioning for that. So, no, who cares? This is much smaller than our power, the computing power of a portable computer. Then this is the room for dispatching, for controlling a certain region in Russia. This is in Russia in 2007. And you can see all the energy can be distributed. Why? Because it's one producer. We had that also, because originally I'm Bulgarian. We had six stations of nuclear power during the Greek Olympiad. All the power was coming from Bulgaria, and now because of entering the Europe, our people, our rulers, they decided they will promise, and they promised, and they switched off four of the stations. It was a very nice solution to make now Bulgaria, instead of producer, to be a consumer. But anyway, this is the future. We will probably not have any of these big producers of energy. This is the past, the big producer of energy and dispatching the energy. How to do when we have 2 kilowatts of power that is produced and thousands of people that produce this many, 2 or 4 kilowatts, but we need to supply the megawatts. How? Okay, we have now the smaller producers. We can see that the smaller producers are very good. It looks nice. Of course, it is more expensive, but it looks nice. And then all this power we need to supply synchronously to that one that I have shown that has 60 hertz and no millihertz of difference. Well, this will be a problem, because we have a consumer making more consumption, the frequency is going lower. We have a producer, we make more production, the frequency is going higher. How to make all this to be when our fluctuation in the consumption is so fast that we cannot cope with that? Our producers are individuals, and they can produce and put to the grid because they want to get their money, as it is already made a contract. Some of them, they are really not very nicely made the contracts, which are receiving money from the taxpayer, but okay, it exists. Anything of this can be good if we have good synchronization. How to do that? Of course, in the northern countries of Europe, we have a lot of the lines that are 150 kilovolt of DC. DC is supplied to the ground, to the shore, because offshore the generator is producing. But how to make a synchronization with something individual? You can see this line, how many are there? If you make this, it is very, very high price. Probably you will receive a Nobel Prize if you can do that for so many producers in the same time. So now we are thinking of micro producing, of microgrids and smart grids. They will make a control of themselves, each one by itself. So this is the renewable energy, and one of them is the photovoltaic. Photovoltaic is a very nice thing. If we don't care about the pollution of the producing of the panels, of the solar panels, then it is a nice thing. Of course, to produce the solar panel is something very different. And we have now new technologies like producing it from plastic, not from semiconductors. But anyway, this is not very high power, because each of the panels maybe will give you 120, maybe even 200, but it will be a very big panel. So we have combinations. After we have combinations, it is making also a contact between them. And this is a big, big problem, because the technician that will make these contacts can be killed. You will get so high voltage that directly to contact this, just imagine, and let's jump ahead to say it is possible probably to connect all this wirelessly. Why to make wire and to be subjected to some 800 volt or something like that? And that is why a colleague here, I'm making this joke, Professor Alex van den Bosse from Gent University, he is also an entrepreneur and he is a very good person. He declared that he is making nothing from his panels, and he has a lot of panels on his house, and he's making just coffee by the DC. He doesn't make any power electronics with that. Okay, now let's see the power electronics. Mostly the renewable sources are DC. We can see here the panel is DC. Okay, let's make coffee, but we can make also DC to AC and inject it into the grid, AC grid. And we have also a battery. If we put now from the grid, rectify and make this power to make energy to be collected in the battery, later we can use it for our computer. Okay, that is another way, but we can do it directly. Why not making a DC converter? Then we have from the DC power again to supply the computer, because our computer has a 19 volt of a charger, and it has normally 11.1 voltage of the 3-cell or 6-cell combination. It depends, of course, but it is very popular, all this 11 volt. So we can make here one conversion, another conversion. Each of these conversions is, for example, 90%. If it is 90%, which is very good, finally we have 81%, because it is this efficiency by that efficiency. And here we have directly, okay, each of our converters, even the DC converter to DC, has its efficiency. But the DC to DC efficiency is much better. Also, our consumers like DC, because our all our lighting now is made by the LEDs. This is very popular at this moment. And the LEDs, they like to be supplied by lower voltage. Otherwise, we are losing a lot of power just by limiting the current that is passing there. So we can have a combination of them, but all of them connected in DC. This is a very good idea. And now the cabling. Cabling is leading us to another solution, another conclusion, that we need to have much higher voltage. This is the 230 volt of AC. That is the one. Here is our losses. Where we have lower losses, this is 1/3 of the losses, but when we have 380 volt DC, this is a voltage which is very popular in the telecommunications. I'm connected to the Dutch industry in this sort of things. And it is very important to say that 48 volt is already almost to stay as a history. We are going to very high voltage, which is not very good for human health, of course, because it is dangerous. But anyway, the conclusion is, the DC was the first, Edison, then grew to AC Hen. That was the Westinghouse. And Westinghouse finally produced a DC egg again. So we can see here what is one of the examples. I have many of them. This is an NTT, the Japanese telecom company, which is making also this kind of experiments to make the battery, to connect it to the servers, to this the power distribution unit of the DC, because it has a special contacts, special sockets. Everything is different. Of course, you cannot change the plus to minus. Of course, it is different. But all this is supplied by the DC. And even you can make almost directly this with a regulator to charge the electric vehicle. You can make from the photovoltaics directly to go to this internal bus. Okay, here is all the countries. Just look how many countries they already use the 380 volt. Of course, the Chinese are losing because they started in the beginning with 240 volt. It was the first country maybe to pass in the telecommunications to supply by 200 by the DC high DC voltage, but it is now changing to the 380 because already accepted by all the countries. Here we have the danger, of course, but the danger in the 380 volt is even going to 800 volt now, because we have here the way to make the protection. We have a certain middle voltage and then we have the minus and plus compared to that. This middle voltage is the middle voltage of the battery, middle voltage of the rectifier, which is very difficult to contain and not to make a damage. And this damage, for example, here you can see this is a arc. The arc in the DC, it is not an arc which you can produce by the photovoltaic panel. This is not possible. But here you have something which can maybe destroy a full airplane. As you can see here, these lithium iron batteries, they made the fire and then make the short circuit. Here is the battery which they the company of producing, that is Corvus. They offer this 1 megawatt hour battery to the University of Vancouver just for experiments. Of course, the company is expecting the students to be their brains further. Here is also another combination, which is very important, that we can use some other materials of several hundreds of hertz to make a megawatt of power from DC, middle voltage DC, to the other, which is, for example, 400 volt for the supplying to the data center. Here we have why the DC is so important. The DC here is making, you can look, 99 point something is the efficiency, which is already so good as it is the old power transformer, the 50 hertz, 60 hertz transformer. So we don't need to make the solution to involve a 50 hertz transformer. We can do it with a magnetic connection. Magnetic is because without transformer, we cannot do this transforming of the voltage from one to another voltage. We always have a magnetic link. Okay, magnetic link was also used in the beginning when I was working in the laboratory for power electronics in Bulgaria. It was mostly for induction heating. The induction heating was produced by high frequency currents that are induced in the material, so it is hardened by the surface, which was very important for many applications. But in the same time, here you can see the laboratory which I also asked, and we had a very good cooperation. The laboratory which made transfer of power at a certain distance. You can see the receiver and the transmitter here, which were connected to make a transfer of power, which we started with many other ways of doing that, but this was just to show that the old type of our experience and our equipment, which we made already available during the years, we can use it now to make also transport of power. This is also another transfer of energy, but very much higher frequency, 10 megahertz. And this is experiment here in Portugal. This is in our laboratory in our university. Here is the general way how it works. So it is a magnetic field that it can pass even if we have air gap. If this air gap is very high, we say that the magnetic link is not very good. If we have a magnetic link that is good, we have very good efficiency. And this was a converter which was made when I was an advisor in the Netherlands. It was a military industry at that time. And it was for supply, just supply. But we disconnected the secondary and we made it by four of these power supplies that was very high power, because each two, here there are two really. When we joined them, they can produce, as at that time was measured, 17 kilowatt at the 97% of efficiency. So it is a very good idea. It is working in many places. We try to make this and to be very much higher the efficiency. Here is shown also why the efficiency is better when we use a very high frequency. At this moment here is shown that if we go to make switching off of the transistor a little bit earlier before finishing all the sinusoid, I can prove that this is a so-called zero voltage switching. Then the next transistor is switched when the voltage is zero and we have a very, very soft transition. That is good. So a lot of people are using this kind of soft switching. And here we have something from the 80s. They tried also, but it is abundant because the efficiency was 80%. Now, in other countries, like in Korea, they started to make it with higher efficiency. Here is something which is higher efficient. And this is in Daejeon, in the KAIST, the Korean Advanced Study Institute. It is very important, like MIT in the United States. Also, one of the directors of MIT is really Korean, and he went there back to be the director of this one. And here is how this is protected from going out of the magnetic field. But all this is magnetic field. So, magnetic. Magnetic field is important for us because it's giving us the best efficiency. We have the biggest power that we can transport is not by electrical field, because our air is not a good isolator. After 60 million volt of meter, that is the intensity of electric field, it will make an arc, it will make a spark, and this is not good for us. So we can make much more with the magnetic field, but unfortunately the magnetic field is diminishing by the distance, by the cube of the distance. Electric field is by the square. Well, how to do that? Of course, we use resonance. The resonant coupling makes the magnetic transmitter to be better connected to the receiver. But how to do that with many, many consumers? Because these kind of Korean products, they are developing it, and one of the colleagues, he's already in the United States and making investments, and people are investing also in his works in many, many of the states of the United States. He made this under the ground, so while going on the road, the car will also receive energy. That is very good. But the frequency of the transmission is, we have always to be aware that we have resonance. So we need to keep very near to the resonance and not to be exactly on the resonance, to be a little bit higher in order to get this zero voltage switching. A lot of the things are even still to be produced. But the final thing which I can say that we have by the European rules now, the maximum 1,500 volt DC is our low voltage. So we are allowed to work with over 1,000 volt DC, which is completely possible to be used as execution, of course. But we need to make it safe. And to make it safe, one of the future solutions which I propose here is to make a standardization of the magnetic field, not the voltage. So we can have receivers and transmitters that will work. If we disconnect them at a certain distance of 20 centimeters, it will be okay. If we connect them, we will get better efficiency, but it will be like our classical converter DC to DC. Just connect them magnetically better and you get with a perfect efficiency of 99%, you get your power on the other side. If we make it at a distance of 20 centimeters, we must be careful that our transmission will be at the best efficiency possible. But of course, it's a lot of things to be introduced at this moment because we are still in the beginning. The cars are not easily admitting to make available the internal software of the car in order to get the power from the grid to the car, to the car battery, and when necessary, to make additional power to take from the car and to put back to the grid. It is not very easy to accept even for the consumer, because when I have my gasoil with my car, in my car, it is for me. I will not give permission to anybody to come there to take some of my fuel and to use it and promising that tomorrow he will give it back with a double of price. Just imagine that I have a child that is ill now and I need to go to the hospital and I find that somebody from the grid was taking my energy and making this to be available only tomorrow. Tomorrow my son will be probably dead. So this is the conclusion. I have a proposal that instead of voltages, we standardize the magnetic field and the frequencies and the way we connect all our transmitters to the receivers, even if they are many, many of them. And for the future, if we have time, I can give you more details about the energy harvesting, the small producers, the small consumers, and how to avoid the batteries, especially for the sensors. It is very possible, but of course it's another slides which I think today is a little bit less than 30 minutes, but it's okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. Yes, since, as you say, there are different subjects, but still, I would like, first of all, to say hello to all of the other participants that joined us. And as we said in the beginning, we have some already questions, but also I would like to invite everyone who just joined to pose a question in the chat or send me a private message, as some of you already did. So the first question, Professor, is probably connection to the Korean story that you gave us. Where are the Koreans actually testing the applications of the transfer? Probably they mean in which areas they are testing the transfer.
Yes, the Korean research in this direction is obviously more inclined into the public transport because they have one line which is in Seoul and one in Daejeon, and they are producing now and they are trying to sell this. Why the public transport? Because you can make the infrastructure below the road with all the with all this. I can give you some impression about that. Below the road you have your inductors, and you have in every 200 meters you have four inductors. They are prolonged, they are longer. And when the bus is coming, you see it is a bus, it's not a very small thing, and you can have big windings, so it is much easier to make good contact magnetically. Of course, they measured the influence inside, and it is okay for the people. You can make isolation, but you need this, and it is not very cheap to have all this magnetic tape here, which is supposed to isolate. Of course, you have a metal plate over the ferrite materials on the bottom. And this metal plate is also for isolation, because all the flux that is fleeing from the connection, it is also making a short circuit there, and it is not entering into the compartment. Why it is public transport? Because you don't need to make a credit card to pay for receiving energy. Can you imagine millions of people with credit cards? Some of them having credit cards, some of them not, some of them having possibility to pay, some of them not, and all this running in a full way in the highways and to get the energy. That's not very possible. What is made of this kind of connections is mostly for one company. For example, to exchange the batteries in Israel, they have the same company which is using the batteries to exchange between the cars. In Tokyo, Tokyo taxis also, they have exchange, automatic, almost robotized exchange of the batteries. So the battery is charging, and when the battery of the car is already empty, the car comes to the station and receives a new battery very, very fast. Then why we are not inclined into this kind of it's easy to say. We are not prepared by the data change.
Yes. Thank you for the answer. Definitely, I think that sums it up for definitely where are the examples of Korean market. But the second question actually is very much connected to this one as well. We are seeing that, as you said, there are different sectors and there are actually different states are investing in different parts of wireless energy transfer. The next question is connected is actually, who leads the investment in this area, in the wireless energy transfer? Who does the most investment? Actually, that is the question. And maybe if I can also, can you give us also, because you've shown us a map of investments so far, who started, who hasn't started yet. What's your personal take? Because there now we see in the global economics also the China, the Russia, EU, US. Who is actually doing the most investment and who is connecting the wireless to the new future of energy, not just of grids, but generally, let's say?
In fact, I know people who are doing that in China, but it is still not very popular, not very widely used. In practice, they have some of chargers that are for 40 kilowatts. In this kind of charger in Korea is 200 kilowatts is each station. Each of these stations is 200 kilowatts with four emitters, four windings, and every 200 meters. It's a lot of investment. In as I know from a colleague in Texas, it was $400,000 per kilometer. So $400,000 per kilometer, if you are ready to put it there, then it may be changing the world. But who will give this investment? If we are not sure who will pay for that, I repeat, by credit cards, private persons, then it is a public transport. If it is a public transport, it's the taxpayer. If it is a taxpayer, it's a decision of the local municipality, it's a decision of the government of the state on this kind of decisions. Where I see these chargers, we have here EFASEC company in the list of the EFASEC production. There is also a wireless charger, and wireless charger is for a smaller power, about 3 kilowatts, which is normally what is available in the world, and some other bigger charger. But in fact, it is just a promise, because to produce it, you need to have clients. And for the moment, even if you try to buy some of these chargers, which are announced in the world, you will be put in the waiting list, because they are still making marketing. It's not really starting. The first company which comes probably will be losing money, because something is not very easy to preview what will happen. I'm not sure if I know some company which is making this wirelessly, because as I can show again this one here. This one was produced in the United States in the 80s. It was even very, very good machine. You put it this palm, you put it inside the slot, then automatically ferromagnetic material is closing it, making it a very good magnetic connection, even though the efficiency was 80%. So people, American people are very rational people. When they say that I'm paying 100%, but I receive only 80%, that makes no sense. So just the wire is more dangerous when it is rain, when it is wind, when it is say not very experienced person, it can be very dangerous. This is not dangerous because you don't touch any voltage here. It's just magnetic field. You put it there in and it starts to charge, but you lose 20%. If you pay $100, you lose $20. It's not very easy to accept like that. So people change back to their wiring system. And normally when you see the cars that are now charged, they need a wire. They go to the wire, you put it the socket on you put the wire in the socket, in the street or in the special station, but not the wirelessly. Wireless transfer of energy can solve many problems because the highest density of current in the flexible cables doesn't allow to have more than 500, 600 amperes cable in the market. This is the highest amperes. 600 ampere, you can buy still a flexible cable, but it's very, very big. It's maybe more than 150 square millimeters cable. It's very heavy cable and very expensive because inside the cable, you have a higher temperature and the current is going on the surface, like in the surface effect of the high frequencies. It's something very similar. So it is not very good. Then if we have this kind of cables, it's because we need to get contact with the station that is charging. If we have a wireless charging, you can make it like a bar, a copper bar can be of much smaller size and it will get the best use of the copper because you don't need to have 1-2 amperes per square millimeter. How is the reality in these high power cables? In the wall we have 11 amperes per square millimeter in the wall because you can get easily the heat out. But in the flexible cable for charging, this kind of 500 amperes is passing in small parallel wires, and the hot wires will not conduct, the cooler wires will be on the surface. It is not a very good idea. If it is a copper bar, then we get much smaller size, but we need higher frequency. Then we have another problem, the higher frequency with the bars. It's another problem with the effect of the surface conducting when the frequency is getting higher. But it is a solvable problem. At least in Korea, the frequency of this charging of the buses in Korea is 20 kilohertz. It's very low frequency. For our perception of frequencies, which normally what is announced in the world for these systems that are for wireless charging, normally they say 80, 100, 110 kilohertz, not 20. 20 because the winding here is much, much bigger. So I don't know when, but for the moment, the people are divided because who can give big money for that is only the public services, like state government or the municipality. But the company, to make this production, the company must be sure that people will buy that production and not not making use for another car, for another brand, because then it makes no sense. They must get their money back, or they make production of something which is much more universal. And that is my idea. If we have a car like Leaf that is 275 volt, and you have a Tesla which is 375 volt battery, that is charging needs more higher voltage, and it will be faster if it is even higher the voltage Then we need a regulator which is putting this current inside the battery to be kept there as energy. Is it a very good idea? For the moment, we need it. In the future, who knows? Just to make another interruption here and to say, we have also the gas system of Germany has 10 times more power and 10 times more energy compared to the electric system. And Germany is not a small country. Now, if we are thinking about the gas, recently in the last 2-3 years in Germany, they are checking all the tubes of the natural gas system if it is possible to accept the hydrogen. And now, if we have a hydrogen, we can use it for burning, for making power. Of course, it is not very good, but we can use it for fuel cell. And fuel cell is another way to receive power from the fuels, but without burning them, just making water. If we have a hydrocarbonic material like methanol, for example, it is possible. But with methanol, there is a problem. Also, we have some CO2, but it is not the same danger that we have when we have a burning, the real burning of the fuel. Sorry, no. Maybe we are making it too long. I don't know.
No. Absolutely. I think the first of all, the people who asked you are very thankful. So I think you definitely have also given the examples. Thank you very much for the Korean market and now actually your view also of the future. So hopefully we will also develop some kind of new solutions, as you also say, with. Yeah.
Also, I don't know the Korea, sorry to interrupt you. Korea, I have contact with that colleague that is now in the United States. Sometimes we exchange some thoughts with the Korean colleagues, but I haven't been there. These photographs are almost 10 years old. This is when I was, that is my photographing, that wiring, wireless energy in Korea. Sorry for interrupting you. I can, if I am prepared, if you give me time, I can be prepared to see what is exactly the situation in this moment.
Okay. In that regard, actually, what we were talking about, we will hopefully in the future, of course, we will definitely develop different kind of solutions using different kind of materials and generate this kind different kind of transmission of energy and wirelesses. As we can see, being tested and definitely is one of them. With these notions, we are actually finishing the webinar. I would also, first of all, like to thank once more Professor Stanimir. Thank you very much for being our guest and giving the lecture. I think it broadened up our scope definitely, and we now can see the different opportunities in this sector being shown and being actually tested and realized by some of the states. That being said, also, since Internet of Energy is, as I said at the beginning, such a broad subject, and we, through the project, have many examples, I invite all of the participants also to, again, visit our website, follow us on Facebook, follow us on LinkedIn, on our groups, where generally every week now we have actually a webinar from different kinds of subjects, from different kinds of areas of Internet of Energy. So with that being said, I would like to thank you again, everyone, for being part of the webinar. You will also get this the video of the webinar on your mail. And also you can, here I'm going to share my screen again, visit our website and see all of the webinars that we have already done and the ones that we will be working on for the next 2 and 3 months. Thank you again, everyone. Have a nice day and have an, as we say, productive week here, because it's Monday, it's the start. And join us also next week for the next webinar organized by Internet of Energy. Again, thank you very much, Professor, and everyone. Well, we will be definitely, when it comes to webinar, keeping in touch. And that is all from Madame Park, and goodbye.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you all.